Last time we have seen this data flow level modeling, everything like how important they are, that understanding of this, what they infer. Infer means the logic they infer. That is, if you use this one. So the point here for using this HDL itself is the generate the hardware, digital hardware. So, but in case if you use this one, tool what it will infer. Inferring is a what it will produce. It may produce for you carry save adder or carry look ahead adder. Those things last time we have discussed. So ripple carry adder like that, it may produce anything for you. So that is one thing that we have last time discussed. And other than that, we also have seen that some are tool dependent dependencies. The second point that we discussed is tool dependency. Tool dependency, like suppose, for example, if you have array. Tool dependency, such as where is that? Is it seen by everyone?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, tool dependency, such as if you use this particular division operator, that is this slash, forward slash. So, your XST tool may behave differently. Your XST tool, that is from the Xilinx, it may behave differently. Meaning, this operator could be anything. This operand, not operator. This operand could be anything, but this operator, it should be in terms of powers of 2, that is 2, 2 power 2, 2 power 3, like that. Then only this XST tool is going to give you the hardware netlist. It is supporting, that is, synthesis is possible. If you are using other than this 2 power 3, A divided by 3, then it is not going to synthesize who this XST tool. So it means from that what we have concluded, this usage of operators, whether they support for netlist giving or not, that depends upon the tool usage. What tool we are using, whether that tool is supporting or not for synthesis. So we have to consult once EDA tool manual. The tool manual. What suppose if you are using a cadence in your college, there is a cadence is there. In this cadence, if you are using what we call that RTL compiler, you have tool called RTL compiler. This RTL compiler is from whom? From cadence. Now they are calling it as a some name, they gave some name that is some Innovus is for backend tool. For this, they gave some other name. So anyway, that name, if you keep aside, RTL compiler is a synthesis tool from the cadence. So what operators among these they are supporting for synthesis, that we have to know before using. So that is the other point that we have discussed last time. And coming to this important point, this is, if one is X unknown, then what would be the our result? Result will be unknown. That is the another point important we should not forget. And there are unary operators. Unary operators means which will make use of only one operand. So plus 5. So this is one operand. 5 is one operand. So I may use 5 plus 3 also. So here this is one operand, this is another operand. In that case, this plus is acting like a, instead unary, it is acting like a binary. So two are there. So it's a binary operator. That also we have seen. But this usage of this straight minus 5, minus 3, such usage is not encouraged by the designers. That also we have seen last time. Now, coming to this one logical relational equality operator. All these three we have seen last time. Now, moving ahead in this important point is, these are the important points. Everything is important here. 1, 2, 3. So, logical operators always evaluate to 1 bit. That is true. It may evaluate to only 1 bit. The final result will be 1 bit. So that may be a 0, that may be a 1, or it may be x also. So in case if x is coming, how that compiler is going to treat that one, that depends upon more, is a compiler, simulator, normally treated by simulators as false condition, as false condition, meaning 0 only. Even if 0 is coming, it is treated like a false condition by the simulators. So this also we should not forget, usage of this logical operators, this one. Now, coming to this, logical operators take a variable or expressions as operands. Usage of parentheses, so better to use parentheses because this operator precedency is there, this one is there, this one. So first they will be given the higher priority, then after these are given the priority. So if we mess up usage of this, then we may think something else. Because of this precedent, operator precedence, tool may be performing differently. To avoid that conflict, we have to use this parentheses. You have to use. So use parentheses, then for user, for compiler, for user, designer, and the compiler, there will not be any issue. So that is what about this logical operators. Last time we have seen, for example, examples if you consider here A is 3, B is 0 is considered. And we are trying to evaluate this A and B. What would be the final result if we do that way, if A and B, then you are looking for some statements to be executed. So, but there happens to be A 3, there happens to be B value 0 in this example, take an example. How is that this statement, if the statement is evaluated? So it evaluates to 0. So that is what we have to understand. Why it is evaluating to 0 means this value, non-zero value, is treated as a logical 1. And this 0 value is anywhere treated as a logical 0. So for that reason, 1 and 0 when evaluated, that is result is treated as a logical 0. It evaluates to 0. Similarly, if A or B coming in the same example, where A is 3 and B is 1, it is evaluating to 1 because of this OR property. Similarly, if you take this negation, that is being said already unary, it takes only one operand. So we have a negation 4. Negation 4 means it is not going to perform negation over this 4. 4 means that binary equivalent to 1, 0, 0. Over that, it is not going to perform your negation. So simply, it's a logical sense. If this is a value, there is a value, it is a logical 1. It is treated by the compiler as a logical 1. Since we are performing negation of logical 1, because logical 1, because there is a non-zero value, so it returns, because here, yeah, just because our A is the similarly, if you see the B, it is known, because just B is 0, negation of that is a 1. So it is evaluated to that 1. So now the cases are with the unknowns. We have this A unknown and B a known value. So how is that going to evaluate? It evaluates to unknown. Unknown, when it is evaluated to unknown, as we said earlier here, it depends upon the compiler, how compiler treats it. Most of the compilers, 99.9% compilers, will treat unknown as a false only. That's why here A and B means unknown and known value is evaluated to unknown value. Unknown value is treated by the compiler as a logical 0. So that is false. So expressions here, expressions such as like A is 2, A is equal to 2. and b is equal to 3. This is the expression. So if this happens to be true, if this also happens to be true, both are true, then only it evaluates to 1. Otherwise, it evaluates to false. So such expressions are also possible in a logical operator. Now, relational operators, we have greater than, less than. This greater than or equal to, less than or equal to. In this, again, the very important point is how it is going to treat them, this one, these values. If there are any unknown, that is x or z, high impedance state z or z. So such expressions are treated like a x. So if there are any unknown x or z bits in the operands, the expression takes a value x, that is unknown. These operators function exactly, that is like a C. In the C also we have similar to C, they behave. So, but the point here is this one is important. Now few examples of that. We have this one. And another example, if we have this one and this one and this one, wherein we have X unknowns. We are checking this one. A less than B, so what would be the result? A is 4, B is 3. So A is A less than or equal to B? Answer is no. It's not less than nor is equal. So it is false. False means logical zero. A greater than B? Yes, it is true. True means logical one. Y is greater than X. This Y is greater than X. If you evaluate this Y value, this is 12 and this is 1. So this is 13 actually. This is 10. So that is Y greater than or equal to X? Yes, it is greater than. So it is evaluating to true. True means logical one. Is Y less than X? This 13 is less than this X. In this Z is less than Z. In this Z we have X values, unknown. So overall result is unknown. Unknown means compiler, how it deals? It deals like a logical. So that's how we have to remember them. We have to understand the usage. Now coming to this equality operators. This we have seen. This is the logical equality, logical inequality. Case equality, this is a triple equal. We have triple equal. That we should not be messing up with this one. The difference is, in this both operands, if have 1 or 0, then only this is going to check. This also checks. If the other side, if there is a x and a 0, z, and the other side here, x, 0, z, such operands, if you want to make a comparison, then you cannot use double equal. Are they equal? For checking this two, you cannot use this double equal. You have to use triple equal. That's called case equality. So now, for example, in this case, A equal to B. Result unknown if X or Z in A or B is there. So we are using A equal to B. But A equal to B is actually meant for logical equality checking, meaning in that 1 or 0 should be there, either case, in A or B. If there would be any X or Z, then this result is unknown, that is X. So how compiler treats most of the compilers to X, they treat like a logical zero. Now comes A not equal to B. In this case also, since it is logical inequality, so in that case also, if X or Z, unknown and Z, high impedance state are there, then the result will be unknown. So that is already we have seen. Now coming to this case equality, case inequality, in such cases, it also includes X and Z. So depending upon that, it will result our result either may be 0 or 1 or 0 or 1. In this case, it may return 0, 1 or X also. So these are the example cases. These example cases you can work. This I think I did not share. I don't know, but today I will share so you can go through these examples. Let us proceed to understand bitwise and bit reduction. Because if you see last time, as Dean said, you have the same even this one. And you have this one here, same. It's also same. Even this one is same. So in 1, 2, 3, 4. All these four are here also repeated. 1, 2, 3, 4. So they are coming in bitwise and reduction as well. But if you observe the other side, this one is a 2. Second also 2, third also 2, the fourth also 2. So it's taking 2 operands. But if you make the observation here, this one and this one, everything here, reduction, all reduction, these operands, if you see, these operands are whether we have connectivity or we lost. Are the people there? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, kindly alert me immediately on WhatsApp. Okay. So, now, in case if I'm losing the connection. So, that's how the things are here. Let us see with the further elaboration here. Bitwise operators here. This bitwise, we have to remember this one. 1, 2, this one. 3, this one. 4, this one. So here, this last time been said that this is a, you have to remember, it's a caret operator, you say, and this is a tilde operator. So put together, either way, you can first caret and then tilde, and the R first tilde and then caret. No problem. That is a XNOR. That is XNOR. If you have only this this caret, then that is XOR. You have this vertical bar, that is R operation. And if you have this ampersand, it's an AND operation. This one tilde is their negation operator. So this bitwise operators perform bit by bit operation on two operands. This, we have seen two operands, but this is the exception case. Exception case is this one. So if you see this one here, let me clear this one. All are 2. You note this one. But exception is this one. What is this exception with this one? What is this bitwise negation? Remember, bitwise negation is the one, it takes only one operand. Rest all bitwise are taking two operands. So that's the important point we have to remember. We should not be making any mistake. Especially new learners. Then they take each bit one operand and perform the operation with corresponding bit in the other operand. If one operand is shorter than other, suppose say A we have 1010, B we have 101. That case we are talking. If one operand is shorter than the other, it will be bit extended with zeros to match the length of the longer operand. In these two cases, which one is the longer, which is the longer. So what happens, this B, you know, compiler automatically appends the required number of zeros so that this length L2 can be matched with the L1. If L1 is greater than L2, in the L2 case, bits are appended in the MSB side. Zeros are appended. Is that clear, this point? Is that clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yeah, Z is treated as an X in a bitwise operation. There is this one important. How, if high impedance states are there, then how it is going to create? Your A has got maybe 4 take B, 1, 0, 1, Z. So how this high impedance state are treated in case if you use this one bitwise operators? It is treated as unknown. That is the point. The exception is the unary negation, which takes only one operand and operates on bits of a single operand. So that is, you can put negation A. If you have 4 take B 1010, then everything will be complemented like a 0101. So this is the negation of this A. If A is this, then negation of this will be that. So that is only single operand here. Single operand is taken, this negation. So now this truth table we have to remember, because this, if we said here, if it is there, here this one, this that is there means it will treat like X. So if your A is having 4 tick B 101Z, and if B is having 4 tick B 0011, and you are trying to perform A and B operation. So this case is happening here. This is happening. Z is ANDed with 1. Now, since Z already said that the Z is treated like X here. It's treated like X. So that's why in this table you will not see Z. You see only X everywhere. You see only. So that's why this is treated like a Z. This Z is treated like a X now. So X and 1, if both are ANDed, the result is unknown. So that's how you have to conclude. So that's where these tables we have to remember, they play important role. If 00 is there, then no problem. If 01 is there, no problem. If 0x also there, no problem. Because you know, in case of AND gate, what happens if 1 is 0? The result will be 0. Irrespective of this one here, 01x. That's what exactly this first one is, this one. And you know this case here, the second one. So if you have the one, it depends upon what it is here, this A. If A is 0, then your result is also 0. If A is 1, then result also 1. If A is X, result also X. So this one is what? Second one. That's how we have to remember this. How we have to remember means there is an easy way, because how AND gate behaves, if you remember, that's enough. Similarly, every gate here, you see this functionality also. So generally what happens in XOR case, 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1. In this case, it's 0, it's a 1, it's 1, it's a 0. So if we have one X is happening. So this one X is this one. You see this X, you see the one. So one X, when unknown is there, you have to put an unknown in case of this one. Similarly, if you take this one, 0 and X case, it is 0 and X. This cannot be a known value, it is a X again, in this case of X or X. That's how we have to remember. So this is about this table important. We cannot neglect as a designer, you shouldn't be neglecting this table, how this behavior is. So all these are examples again. You can work out this, I will share. Coming to the reduction, this is important because we have to understand here reduction and bitwise. So that's why we let us move to this one. In reduction, What you don't see is this. You don't see. There is no this one. You see here, and is there, and is there, or is there, nor is there. This is x not there, x nor is there. This is x not there, x nor is there. But there is no not. There is no not negation in a reduction. That is one thing you have to remember. The other is reduction operators take only one operand. This also you have to remember. Reduction operators perform bitwise operation on a single vector operand and yield one bit result. So there is a lead to one bit. That also you have to remember. One and two, and this is not there. Three. You have to remember this. So what is the difference that we are going to see now? The difference is that bitwise operations are on bits from two different operands. You see here this one. Bitwise reduction. This is reduction we are talking about. And here it is a bitwise. Earlier we have seen operations are on bits from two different operands. That is one difference. Whereas reduction operations are on the bits of the same operand. Same operand, meaning only one operand. This is the second, this is the observation that we have to make. Reduction operators work bit by bit from right to left. That is 101. I have. So starting from right and moving towards left. They work like that. Meaning if you take AND A. And what is A? A is, let us say, 4 tick B, this one. So what would be the result? Why here if you perform this one, it leads to here as said one bit result. Why will have ultimately one bit? So how it is going to perform? Reduction operators work bit by bit from right to left. So this is performed AND operation. 0 ANDed with 1. So result is 0. So that 0 is ANDed with this 0. Result is 0. That 0 is ANDed with this 1. Result is 0. So ultimately this Y is going to have. So that is one thing that we have to understand. The important one more point that is required to be focused is, what about X? If we have X, then what happens? That is also the point that we have to understand. I think I did not mention in this. So that is obviously to the unknown. It results to the unknown. That follows again, unknown means that follows again these rules. These rules it follows. These rules it follows. If you are performing X with X, in a AND, a reduction AND, if you are using, it follows this table. That's why this table this table remembrance is for bitwise also important. What other? This one, two are there, no? Bitwise and reduction. In both cases, this table remembrance is required. How it is going to perform this operation? Reduction. So, if you take another example, X equal to, you have 4 tick B 1010. So if you perform this operation and you are performing like this one, that is a let me clear this. So you have A 4 tick B 1010. And given to Y, tilde is this is a tilde, this is a caret A, this is a semicolon. Now this is performed X NOR operation. So according to this one, reduction operators right to left. So right here and move towards left. So zero X NORed with the one. So obviously we have to remember this table 0, 1, 1 0 1 1. In this case, what is this? 0 0 1. This is 0. This is 0. This is 1. Am I correct in this XNOR case? This one. Now, if you perform 0 1, this one result is 0. Result is 0. So 0 is performed again with this. What performed this operation? What is that operation? XNOR operation. So that is going to lead 1. And 1 is again XNOR with this bit 1. 1 XNOR with this 1 result to 1. So ultimately this Y is going to have 1. Is that clear? Can someone acknowledge?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So that way these reduction operators are used. Here a few examples are there. You just go through this. I will share with you people. Now coming to this shift operators. Only important point that we have to understand is arithmetic right shift, this right shift. You have this greater than, double greater than. And here you have triple greater than. And difference between these two, there is no difference between left shift and arithmetic left shift. There is no difference. There is a difference between these two that you have to understand. This one, for example, if you have this, suppose I have 4, pick B 1 0 1 0. Let us say this is A. I am performing arithmetic right shift by 2 bits. Arithmetic right shift operator is this, greater than this. How many bits? By 2 bits. I have to put that 2 bits here. If I want to perform 1 bit right shift, I have to put here. Remember, this side you are keeping how many bits position you want to make a shift. That you are keeping here. Now what happens in this first case? 2 bits here, if you are moving, this you are losing, this you are losing, this 0 and 1 will occupy here, 0 and 1. Here, this vacant positions here, this vacant position here, will be filled with the zeros in case of right shift. Simply right shift. This is also called logical right shift. If you take arithmetic right shift, then these vacant positions are not filled with zeros. These vacant positions are filled with, this is treated like a sine bit. This is treated like a sine bit in case of arithmetic right shift operator. So meaning what? This number is a negative number. This entire number what is shown is a negative number. So, though you are performing the negative, shift over a negative number, that negative number still be a negative number. It cannot be a positive number. General concept is that. General concept is, if there is a number, maybe 10, maybe 8 or whatever, if you have that is a negative number. If you have performed right shift, arithmetic right shift of that particular number, that number remains with its sign, maybe positive, maybe negative. Sign will not be, there will not be any change in the sign. That's the point we have to understand when we deal with the arithmetic right shift. You have this number. How it is going to treat compiler if you use this, let me take a different color. If you use this one, that is arithmetic right shift, in that case, instantly this operand is treated like a signed number, signed number. In a signed number, this MSB is treated like a signed bit. Signed bit. Though you change, shift the number, but number property, the sign property will not change, no. That remains negative number only. So for that reason, if you perform two bit right shift, meaning one more you have to put here. Twice you are performing right shift, meaning this will come here, that is 0, 1. But this vacant position this time will not be filled with zeros, will be filled with 1, 1. Negative is the sign bit. Sign bit. So with the sign bit we fill. With the sign bit we fill. Is that clear? Is that clear?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So sign bit means that. So
yes,
those who, when question should come, then what is the use when we use such operators? That is the actual learning aspect. Learning aspect should be, okay, that is their language is behaving like that, but what is the point of having such behavior of the operators? That is the learning aspects question. So in that, if that is the learning aspect question, answer is we have some algorithms. For example, if you refer this Booth multiplication algorithm, and there is a called a modified Booth algorithm, modified this Booth multiplication algorithm. So in this Booth multiplication algorithm or modified Booth multiplication algorithm, there are times where we have to perform arithmetic shifts. We have to perform arithmetic shifts there where we use such operators to build a behavioral level modeling, to build behavioral level algorithmic level modeling or behavioral level modeling. We need such operators wherein even sign matters. Sign matters of the numbers, because your multiplication may you cannot all the time say that I perform plus into plus only. You may perform plus into minus also. You may perform minus into plus also. You may perform minus into minus also. So meaning what? Sign has come into the picture now. So if sign has come into the picture, there should be operand which deals with that sign. That is there where this operators are playing role. If we don't have them, then we have to find other ways around to work out. But there are operators which deal with the sign also. That is what the learning aspect of this shift operator. So now coming to the concatenation. Concatenation, suppose say we have, for example, you have here your A equal to 2 tick B, 1, 0. B equal to 3 tick B, 1, 0, 1. Now you have reg, and the size of this is a vector type. It is a 4 colon 0. And this is Y. So now to Y, what you want to assign, the combination of these two you want to assign. How do you do that? So that is where this concatenation comes in. Now I can concatenate A, comma. So these 2 bits, 1, 0, and these 3 bits, 1, 0, 1, put together 5 bits are taken and assigned to this 5-bit size here, 5-bit size. That is how this concatenation operator is playing role. Now the question is, learning aspect question is, what if my Y is of size only, say this is my reg, 2 colon 0 only. And what you are assigning here by concatenation is beyond that. So 5 bits you are coming here, 5 bits earlier, I just erased 5 bits. So in that case, from right hand side assignment will be done. Left hand side higher bits will be discarded. This discards. They are discarded here because assignment is done from the right hand side bit here to LSB here, Y of 0. then y of 1, y of 2. Here from the 0, 1, 2 bits. And the 3, 4 bits, these are discarded because the strength of this y is to hold only 3 bits. So higher bits are discarded. Is that clear, this concept? Is that clear, this concatenation of concept?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So replication. Replication is another powerful tool. In a, most of the time, sometimes we find them in a test benches. Their use may not be the design. In the case of design, in the case of design, we use this. This one most likely we probably use in the test benches most frequently. So the use is suppose say I have this A, 2 tick B 1 0. So I don't, this is 2 bits. Now I have here y, this is the size is 5 colon 0. So meaning 6 bits. I have this only 2 bits. And I want to have repeatedly this A, A, A. 3 times, I don't want this 3 times. I put simply 3A. This is equal to this one. This one. Is that clear? This one? This one? That is that. This one. Duplication. Duplication is instead of writing these many times. How many times I want to duplicate this A, I put that number here, 3 times I want, and what is that I want to duplicate A. And the syntax is this curly braces here and curly braces here. And the number here and what I want to duplicate here. Is that clear? This one? Okay. Now finally this conditional operator. Conditional operator is like you have this A, B and Y and this is S. If S is 0, then A is assigned here. If 1, then B is assigned here. So Y is, S is that true? This is nothing but checking like if y equal to s is equal to 1. These two are same. And if this is happening, we want b. So we put a statement that is colon. If this is not happening means 0, the other one is 0, false statement, it is and semicolon. So if you want to put explicitly this one, you can put like this one. Is that true? In that case, you cannot put this B here, you should put A. And then, is that clear understanding here? If you put simply yes, compiler is going to treat whether yes is 1. If yes is 1, true statement. This is called true statement. True statement. Otherwise, false statement. So, that's how it's... You can have a multiple also. You can have like suppose say y equal to yes is 2, then you can put here yes 2 is the true. If not true, then you can go here false statement, and you can put here again statements here. like that. This is nested. Are you getting this point? Nested like that also possible. It is not compulsory that immediately you have to put only one statement, one statement. No, you can have inside multiple. It is nested. So that is this conditional of it. It's also called ternary operator. So now it's done. Multiplication also done. This one, you look at this one. No, nothing else here. So that is we have done with that. Now the point is one point here. We have to discuss something important. There's something important is, suppose say you have this big module. Inside this module, you are having this module and another module. And like that, and you are connecting from here. And you have some inputs here. And some outputs here. Now these inputs here, what are inputs are coming? They may be going here, and they also may be going here also, no problem. And outputs, some may be going here, and even some may be coming here also. And some may be going back here. Like that also. So some may be coming here again here. But the point what I'm trying to make here is, people are not getting the concept because a WhatsApp conversation happened today with some person. So these are actually primary inputs. And these are actually primary outputs, and all the signals here, you see the signals, you see this signal. So these signals are, they are intermediate signals. Now, why I took up this point suddenly from data flow modeling operators, we wrapped actually data flow level modeling discussion, operators discussion over. Next session, one or two examples we'll see, and we'll simulate and synthesize, and we move to the behavioral level modeling. So that's why I just wrapped data flow level modeling all operators discussion. But this point, because we are moving next session onwards behavioral level modeling, I had to discuss this one. But people are still having doubt, primary inputs, primary outputs, and intermediate signals. Now what you do, this is your top module. This is your internal module 1, this is L1, L2. Now what you declare here as a module, top here, this list should include only primary inputs and primary outputs, that's it. No intermediate signal. No intermediate signal. Intermediate signal, this signal is not listed here. Here only primary input and primary output. Now what you do, you instantiate, you put a here, this primary inputs type here, you put here input and output keywords you use only for this primary, this listed, what you have listed here, them you use here, them only you use this terms here. Now what you have to do, you have to instantiate L1 and L2. So when you instantiate L1 and L2 and you give some instantiation name IN1 and IN2, and here you have to appropriately port binding. Already we have discussed it in previous videos, it is there, you please check for port association, port mapping. Now what the point I am trying to tell, this is important. Primary input, this one is going here, this one is going here, no issues with that. But if you see to the L2, this signal, you see this signal is coming from L1, and let us say this is a vector type, this is a vector type, and let us give this net name as a some Y1. So that vector here you have to mention here like a wire. And the size of that, let us say 5:0, and that is Y1. And now you have to appropriately put here, where suppose say here all inputs comes here. Here output. Output is this Y1 here. You see L1. This L1, for this L1, Y1 is the output here. So in this output side it should come. But if you see the L2, it is coming like a input here. So now you put here as an input side here, this one input side here, this Y1 here and Y1 here. And then you put here outputs here, your outputs here, here your outputs. These outputs. And this one is your, you say net again here. This is going here and coming to this one here. This can act like a wire, or it can act like a in out. So the care is, this care, binding care, how do you bind internal modules, L1, L2? This wire is important. If wire is a scalar type, if it happens to be this is a scalar, say this is a W1. This W1 is a scalar type. And this is here output here. It is output here. So you have to put here, you don't need to write here wire here. You don't need to write wire W1. This the wire W1 not required to mention. You can put straight here the W1 and here at the input side W1. This binding happens automatically by the tool. Is that clear to everyone there?
Yes, sir. It is clear.
So these primary inputs, primary outputs, how to handle them, intermediate signals such as this and this, how to handle them, these things we have to work out. One or two demo I will give, no problem. But tomorrow, since we are going to start tomorrow, behavioral level modeling, few examples on this. Today we, what is that? It's data flow level modeling. Today we completed this data flow level modeling, all required this, what we call this one, operators. Because in the data flow, the life breath is these operators. So these operators is actually life for the data flow. So this we have covered. Now modeling, how to model, how to describe. Model means describe hardware using this operators. That we will see in tomorrow session. After that, we have to go to the behavioral level modeling. So in that behavioral level modeling, sometimes we also present this this type of modeling. This is called actually structural level modeling. We also present side by behavioral level modeling is structural level modeling, because we have to wrap our this ongoing class. That's why we parallelly go structural level modeling and behavioral level modeling. So this is called actually structural level modeling. This top level module. This top, what you are doing is a structural level. This is a structural level, and your lower level, lower this L1 can be in a data flow or in a behavioral level or in a gate level. It can be in any of the lower abstraction levels that already we have seen. So this also, it can be any of the lower abstraction levels, but top level that you see here is a structural level. How we bind structural level modeling, if we have intermediate signals, that is important. That is important. So only primary are taken care here for with the keyword input, with the keyword output, not intermediate signals. Intermediate signals if, are vector type, they are taken care to declare, define, and they are properly binded like that. If intermediate signals are scalar type, they, if you don't declare also, but bind it properly, where the output section is there, you put a, this W1, where input section is there, you put properly for proper binding, that is positional binding. Otherwise, you use named binding. So, but anyway, the point is, this care, structural level modeling, the binding care is essential. Many are lacking that, because in WhatsApp, the communication I have seen from different people. I will demonstrate one or two examples, such examples, like in-out example is there here. You see, this is going like this. How you handle such signals? I will demonstrate this also. But just telling you, briefing you that, understand what is your design primary inputs, what are your primary output, design primary outputs, what signals are your intermediate signals. That identification, you please explore, understand. So with that, today's session we wrap, and tomorrow we will see this data flow level modeling description, that examples. So with that said, let us today's session we conclude.